On February 6, 1973, about 200 members of the American Indian Movement showed up to protest at the Custer County Courthouse. They had with them Sarah Bedhart Bull, whose son Wesley was the young man who had been stabbed to death in Custer County. They were there to protest the injustice and hopefully to meet with court officials and demand that the stabber in that case be given more than a manslaughter charge. They showed up in the middle of a heavy snowstorm, only to find that about 90 police guards were there. I think that state police and police from other counties had been called in and were preventing anyone from entering the courthouse other than those that they allowed. And they agreed to allow only four delegates from AIM to come in and talk with officials. Those delegates were Russell Means and Dennis Banks and a guy named David Hill, who was a Choctaw member of AIM, and Leonard Crowdog. So the four of them came in, but the people they came to talk with still wouldn't engage with them. Russell Means went outside and tried to bring in the mother of the stabbing victim, and the police refused to allow her to come in or Means to re-enter. And as they tried to re-enter, the police got rough with them, and they actually hit Sarah Bedhart Bull in the face with a police baton, started beating her. And when that happened, the other people, the other AIM members, rushed to her defense, and it turned into a melee. It turned into a huge riot with a lot of injuries on both sides, with a lot of police cars and other automobiles being set on fire, and ultimately the courthouse and the Chamber of Commerce being burned down, and about 30 American Indians being arrested and charged with inciting a riot. Most of them were released, but Sarah Bedhart Bull was among those who were arrested, and she was she spent 5 months in jail for inciting a riot when the guy who had stabbed her son to death had spent one night in jail and got 2 months probation. Immediately afterwards, those who had not been arrested, including Dennis Banks, were protesting outside the jail where the others were held, and most of them were released. The AIM members then returned to the Pine Ridge Reservation to meet there with the elders and chiefs and medicine men. In addition to the situation with the Bedhart Bull family and the Custer Courthouse, the Lakotas at the Pine Ridge Reservation were having to deal with something else also. Their new tribal chair, Dick Wilson, and his Guardians of the Oglala Nation, or Goons, he had quickly turned into an authoritarian. He was accused of several different types of fraud and corruption by the tribal council, particularly by the traditionals and full bloods in the tribe, who said that he tended to favor those who were of the mixed blood rather than full blood, and that he also tended to be extraordinarily chummy, they charged, with the federal government and with the local and state governments to the detriment of his own people. And the tribal council had tried to actually impeach Dick Wilson not long before this, but the process was shut down, not allowed to continue. Meanwhile, he was using his private security, his goons, to intimidate and in some cases harass and even physically attack those who were opposed to him. So the question arose, oh, what's going to be done about this? And that's another thing that the traditionals in the community wanted AIM to help them with. So the AIM leadership met with the tribal council and with the elders and with the community in general. And at that meeting, they were encouraged strongly. They were spurred to action by the some of the older women of the community, including Ellen Moose Kemp and Gladys Bissonette, both pictured here, and Agnes Lamont, whom I couldn't find a picture of, or else I would have had her picture here as well. And also this individual, Frank Foolscrow, who was at that time, this is 1973, so he was in his early to mid 80s. He was the nephew of Black Elk. He was a member of the tribal council, as well as a spiritual leader. And something that's really, really significant about Frank Foolscrow is, by the way, this is a spoiler alert, this is leading up to the incident at Wounded Knee. He was at the first incident of Wounded Knee in 1890 as a small child, and had survived that. Anyway, he spoke to the AIM leaders, and in the photograph that I just had up there, you had pictured Dennis Banks, Russell Means, and Clyde Belfort. He spoke to them in Lakota and urged them to go to Wounded Knee and make their stand. About 200 American Indian Movement members and Ogallala Lakota activists from Pine Ridge converged on the night of February 27th, 1973, on the little hamlet of Wounded Knee, which was inside the Pine Ridge Reservation, but was not owned by, not part of the tribe. It wasn't owned by any Lakotas. It was one of those situations where it was land that had been sold after the Dawes Act and allotment, and had been in the hands of non-Indians since the 1890s. So there was a little trading post there, a few other little buildings with several non-Indian people living there. So they came in and they took 11 hostages, and they barricaded themselves in and took control, declared themselves the independent Oglala Nation, and stated that they were holding the hostages and that they would release them when the federal government agreed to return to the agreements of previous treaties with the Oglala people. Immediately, for 15 miles all around Wounded Knee, the roads were closed down by the federal government. You had the FBI and the U.S. Marshals Service both involved. And then beyond those roadblocks, the goons of Dick Wilson had stationed themselves, I guess, in case anyone got through that one. They had, the federal government had basically armored vehicles, they had machine guns, they had low-flying planes, they had snipers, and the AIM members at the town of Wounded Knee, they had whatever weapons they had brought with them. A lot of them, like Wes Studi, were Vietnam combat veterans. And so they were somewhat experienced in this type of thing. This turned into a 71-day standoff, essentially with Russell Means and Dennis Banks talking to, making statements to the press, who were allowed close enough there. And also at one point, the roadblocks were taken down, the goons were sent away by the federal authorities, and several other supporters of the American Indian Movement and the Oglalas came pouring in, and so their numbers grew from there. And people were watching this on the news, and people were hearing Means and Banks articulate the grievances not only of the Lakotas, but of all Native peoples in the United States. And there was some divided opinion. There were quite a few people who were absolutely aghast that these rowdy Indians would be taking hostages and would be standing off against federal authorities. But there were a lot of other people who were sympathetic to their goals and to the treatment that had led them to this point. And really, Means and Banks almost became like, you know, national celebrities during this time. And it was very tense. There were shots exchanged regularly. Several people on both sides were wounded during the 71 days. Some FBI agents had some injuries. One was shot in the wrist. The most serious injury on the federal side was Deputy United States Marshal Lloyd Grimm, pictured here in the wheelchair, who was shot and as a result was paralyzed from the waist down for the rest of his life. On the Native American side, in addition to various minor, less life-threatening injuries, there were two deaths among the American Indian Movement members. One was Frank Clearwater, who was Eastern Band Cherokee, and he had hitchhiked across the country to get to Pine Ridge to participate in this. And he was shot by a sniper's bullet while he was sleeping on a cot in the church. Buddy Lamont, who was from right there on Pine Ridge, he was Oglala. He was shot the day after Clearwater. I think Clearwater was shot April 26th and Lamont was shot April 27th. That's Lamont's body in the casket there. And the young lady's t-shirt says, "My heart is buried at Wounded Knee." You can see that Lamont has a military portrait. Both these guys were Vietnam veterans. Another casualty, and one of the strangest stories about the occupation, was Ray Robinson, an African-American man from Alabama, who had been very actively involved for about 10 years in the civil rights movement. He had been a follower of Dr. Martin Luther King, and he had been at the March on Washington. He had gone down to Mississippi during the voter registration drive there when so many people were killed. He had been at the Resurrection City, Tent City in 1968. And he came to try to bring the two minority groups together when he heard about what was going on. He was one of, by some accounts, two African Americans, by some accounts, four, who came to help out. Now, there was a bit of a problem and there was some tension because Ray Robinson was not a member of the Black Power movement. He wasn't a Black Panther. He was one of the more mainstream civil rights type people from before that. He was a pacifist, and this was no place for a pacifist. So there was some tension because he didn't participate in the defense of the place. And there was some reports that he tried to be involved in the strategizing, and his approaches did not match up either with the AIM members. And he disappeared. He disappeared and was never seen again. And there are several stories, several different conflicting accounts of what happened to him. Almost all of those accounts involve him being shot in the leg. Some accounts have the AIM members suspecting that he was an FBI spy and shooting him. Some have an angry discussion turning into an altercation where he was shot. Some have him deciding to leave the camp and then being shot after he left by some of the goons. All of them, though, all the different versions have him bleeding to death from having been shot in the leg. And his body was allegedly buried somewhere outside the compound. There was a report recently, I think, that they thought they had found his body out there in the desert area outside Wounded Knee. So we don't know exactly what happened to him, but whatever it was permanent. By the way, the Wounded Knee Medical Clinic during the siege was run by these two extraordinary women. You had Lorelei DeCora, who was Ho-Chunk or Winnebago on her father's side, and on her mother's side was Minneconjou Lakota. And in fact, her great-grandmother had been a survivor of the original Wounded Knee. So there was Lorelei DeCora, who was a nurse, and Madonna Gilbert Thunderhawk, who was from the Cheyenne River Sioux Reservation. And that's her at the far left there with the picture with the gun. That was just too good a picture for me not to use. So the two of them and several other volunteers were in charge there of the clinic. And after the siege, after those events, the following year, 1974, these two women co-founded a new organization called WARN, W-A-R-N, Women of All Red Nations. In addition to being on the news every night for those 71 days, the occupation got some support from the entertainment world, in particular coming from Marlon Brando, who had just won the Academy Award, had just been nominated for the Academy Award for his performance as The Godfather the previous year. And Brando was, he was a heavy favorite to win, justifiably, and he did win. But Brando was very involved, very invested in issues pertaining to American Indian rights. And this was not a new thing. He had actually been arrested in 1964 at a fish-in in Washington State, where he was part of a group that was organized by American Indians protesting the fishing policies that kept them from their traditional fishing grounds. So that was a decade before this happened. So he had a good track record, right, for Native American rights. Well, on the night of the Oscars, March 27th, 1973, which was smack dab in the middle of that 71 days, his name was called as the winner, but he wasn't there. Instead, a young woman came up as his spokesperson, a young Apache actress named Sasheen Littlefeather, who had a statement from Marlon Brando that he was respectfully declining the Oscar due to protest over the treatment of Native Americans in Hollywood and the continued stereotyping of them, plus in protest of what was going on at Wounded Knee at that time. So if you watch this clip, and you can find it on YouTube, you'll see that when she starts talking, it sounds like about half the people there are booing and half are cheering, maybe a little more than half are cheering. But that shows the division, and that same division was in the country. But what that means is that even if half the people were siding with the Indians on this, that's a whole lot of people. This next item pertains to one of my favorite bands from the 70s, Redbone, that maybe you've never heard of. But I bet you have heard of their most popular song. It was actually their first single. Let's see if you recognize it. That song is an awesome song. It was released in the album that came out in November of 1973, a few months after the Wounded Knee siege was over, and then that particular song went as high as number 5 on the pop charts in 1974, and then 40 years later, it was on the charts again after it was released on the soundtrack to Guardians of the Galaxy, which is why I was betting that some of you were familiar with it. It's an awesome song. But I bet you didn't know that the band that sang it are all Native American. They are Yaqui and Shoshone. And I bet you also didn't know that they had another song on that same album that referenced Wounded Knee. Now, the song itself is talking about the 1890 Wounded Knee Massacre, but it was no coincidence that it's being released at this time. And it's no coincidence that although the song charted in several countries, it did not do so in the U.S. because it was not released in the U.S. because it was such a controversial subject. Listen to the lyrics and see if you can figure out why. And I have to tell you that that same album has an awesome song called Wovoka, who was, of course, the Paiute who introduced the ghost dance and who was played, of course, by Wes Studi in the 2007 movie Bury My Heart at Wounded Knee.
Keep on dancing. Keep on dancing. All people must.
Does that pull it all together or what? Unfortunately, they couldn't hold out forever. And the death of Buddy Lamont in particular, as he was a member of the local tribe there that everyone knew, took a lot of the wind out of their sails. And on May the 8th, they surrendered, and hundreds of Indians were arrested, including Wes Studi. But he got the last laugh. Ha ha ha. Anyway, Russell Means and Dennis Banks were arrested and charged with conspiracy. The judge actually threw their cases out as a result of prosecutorial misconduct, and it was ruled that they had double jeopardy and couldn't be retried. However, at one of the trials in Sioux Falls in the spring of 1974, another fight broke out between the police and the AIM members, and here you can see Dennis Banks and Russell Means helping an injured David Hill away from the scene. Anyway, even though the conspiracy charges were thrown out, charges were then brought against Banks and Means for inciting a riot. Banks at the Custer Courthouse and Means at Sioux Falls, and both of them wound up going to prison for about a year.